Welcome back to Programming with Qt Widget. What a blast, huh? Now you know how to do tree models. In this episode, we'll talk about some slightly easier models, namely the value-based model. And following this episode, we'll talk about proxy models, we'll talk about delegates, we'll talk about selections. And finally, I'll give you a pointer to Qt Widgets and more, where there's 20 more episodes to go through on model view. The by far best and most correct way to do model view programming is to instantiate, or rather to subclass and then instantiate, of course, your own models. Meaning you will subclass from QAbstractListModel, QAbstractItemModel, or the most complex one, QAbstractItemModel. But sometimes you just have a bit of data and you're tempted at just giving that to one of the item-based views, namely the QListWidget, the QTableWidget, and the QTreeWidget. But before you go to that temptation, there is a middle ground, namely instantiating one of the two models that do not require subclassing. They are sometimes a bit awkward to work with, and I would see them as a stopgap when you want to not go through the full path of instantiating or subclassing and instantiating your own models, but still do want to hold the option of actually doing it the right way, meaning the option of proxy models and delegates and so on. The two classes I'm talking about is QStandardItemModel, which is the most generic one of them. With that one, you can create both list tables and trees. And the QStringListModel, which is really the by far easiest one, is just a wrapper around a QStringList. I'll show you the QStandardItemModel, how you work with it. It's not difficult, but on the other hand, it's not, at least to me, straightforward. So let's look at this example that I have here. It's a relatively simple example. It creates, as you can see here, a table and a tree, and the tree has some items in it, and that's about it. If we just look at the code here, and let's hide the sidebar so there's more of the code on the screen for you. Going and searching for main is always, as I've said like a million times by now, the best way of getting into a new code base. I have a setup table and a setup tree, and if we go and look at the setup table, maybe I shouldn't have closed it. Setup table is the one that creates this simple table view that we have up here. I create an instance of my QStandardItemModel, and further down, I create an instance of the QTableView, and as with regular model view programming, I call table setModel with a model. And the table view do not know that it's being tricked into a lower life form of a model, because to it, does see a subclass of QAbstractItemModel, which the QStandardItemModel, of course, is. I specify the amount of rows and columns up here, and I set the data this way here. I do need to know a bit of model view programming still, because the way that I call setData is that I go and ask for the index for the row and column, and then set data on it like that. Using QStandardItemModel with tables are straightforward, especially if the table is fixed size, because just as we saw, specify the rows and columns. However, with a tree, you need to do that throughout the whole tree, which, at least when I tried it the first time 15 years ago, was puzzling because I didn't understand how to create the subtree. But let me show you how it works. I have this function setUpTree, and I create an instance of QStandardItemModel, of course, and I call setHorizontalHeaderLabels, which is what sets the headers. Of course, I could have done that with table too, but in tables, it's less common that you have, well, I don't know, but I could have done it. But I call setHeaderLabelTitle and description. This far, easy peasy. Then I need to go and fetch the invisible root, which is a standard item model pointer. So the tree, obviously, in model view has this concept of model indexes that have sub or child model indexes, which might have child model indexes, and we have this child model index representing the top of the tree. Remember? The same thing here. I have a QStandardItem that is at the top of the tree, above any tree item. That's the invisible root item. And now, this code here, you can see if I go down here, you can see I set up both first for the YouTube tree and for the blocks tree. That's what we have underneath there. And I do that with the same code. So let's go down here, see. I create an instance of QStandardItem with YouTube. That's what we see up here. I set the data on the URL role, and that's QT colon colon user role plus one. I don't remember if we talked about that in the previous episodes, but that's the data. We have the display role and decoration roles and tooltip roles and so on. And we can have our own roles, which definitely I'll talk much more about on Qt Widgets and more. And there's a few episodes, and I'll give you a lot of links to that. But we have the URL role here representing one of those pieces of data associated with this item or this model index here. And this role is then stored in whenever I call set data. So I set the data here to the YouTube channel, and if I click on it, I can double click on it, and well, somewhere it should have started up. Well, there we are, started up, and let's not hope that I'll start talking, because this is a link to Qt Widgets and more, so the YouTube channel in KDAB all over. Anyway, it also closed it, but that's a side effect. They set the flags that the item is not editable. That is noticeable though, because when I double clicked on it, I didn't start editing. I would usually do that on double click, but now I set the item is not editable. This is a display only tree, and I need to do it on each and every single of my Q standard items. Had this been proper model view, then the model would just have checked whether in the flags method have returned that it was not editable. But this is my version of calling set flags, which I need to do on each and every item. I then, on my root, that was the invisible root at the top here, the root, append row, and then YouTube. And now I add a number of other rows here. And the way that I add them is that I specify the parent here, I specify the title, the description, and the URL. So the parent, that would be this YouTube note here, the title, the description, and the URL, which is not visible, but when I click on it, it will load that URL. I create for this Qt widgets and more here, this one here, in column 0, I create a new QStandardItemModel. I set the data to be this URL on the URL row. I set it to be not editable. I create another QStandardItem, this time for lots of tips and tricks for widget developer sitting over here, column 1. I create that item. I set the URL and the flags as before, and then I say parent, which would be YouTube down here, parent, append row, and then these two columns. And I do that for all of YouTube and all of blocks. And by the way, go and load up this this example. There's some pretty nifty stuff, both on our blog posts and on YouTube. Finally, I create my tree. And I set the attribute to delete on close, which we've been talking about a million times, which means that when I close it here, it'll actually be deleted. I set the model on the tree to be this model I have all the way up here, my QStandardItemModel. And finally, I expand tree pointer expand. And I want to expand. Maybe I should start it again. You'll see here. You go away and you see YouTube is expanded, blocks is not. And the way that worked is that I said tree pointer expand, but expand is a method of QTreeView. It's actually a QAbstractItemView method, and it takes a Q model index. So I need to go from my YouTube, which was a Q standard item pointer, over to a model index. And there is, fortunately, on Q standard item model, there is a method called index from item, which takes an item and converts it into an index, which I then can call expand on. And as you saw, I could click on the items, and I implemented that not to be able to show you our YouTube channel, because I'm sure you found it already. I'm here. But to show you how I connect the signals and slots, because I have connection here for QAbstractItemView double-clicked. That one brings out a model index, just as you have seen in when we talked about model view in the previous episodes. Takes out a Q model index, and if I want to go and fetch some data, index.data, just as you saw previously, the URL role, which was the role that I put all of these URLs into, and convert that. That gives me a Q variant, and I convert that into a string, test whether that is not empty, and if it's not, it'll start up the URL. Oh, wow, what an anticlimax, huh? After we build up and build up and build up, and we finally managed to implement tree models by subclass and QAbstractItemModel, we now see something as trivial and more or less just walking through the API like I did here. But there is a purpose. I wanted you to see and know that you could do the real tree models by subclassing before I showed you this, because this is only a stopgap. It is when you know that your list or tables or trees are fixed size and they don't have a lot of items, and you will not spend a lot of time setting up those items. Then you can go and do this. And it's still better than using the widget version of QListWidget, QTreeWidget, and so on. But it is still a stopgap. For a good balance of your code, it is always a better idea to subclass from QAbstract list table or item model and implement a real model. And once you have implemented a few trees, it isn't that difficult. Just remember the trick of whatever from index method, when you get that one in, it is straightforward. Of course, you need to figure out what goes into your internal pointer. Did I start talking about the model view of implementing or subclassing QAbstractItemModel again? I just can't help myself. That is the right way, and I've done that multiple times over the last 10, 15 years, and it is worthwhile it. This is the stopgap, but I said that a few times by now, haven't I? So let's just end the episode here in a greetings. Until next time, have a great time. Oh no, black and white, yes, but don't say that it's over. It was just so much fun. Oh well, if you want more Jesper, then go and check out the Qt Widgets and More videos. We have more than 100 videos there by now.